Ladies and gentlemen, I would like to present something on the Theriomai seeds. It has been sort of well presented already throughout different talks in this workshop already, so I'll not touch on all of the aspects, but I would like to share some things with you. So this is really a community effort, and you will see there are some full stops there. So it means everybody is invited to contribute, to add some data, to add comments, to add opinions. So these are people that already gave input into this project, and but you are all welcome to add your opinions as well. So as a class, this is quite a big group. We have at least 26 authors currently listed in this class. There are about 136 families listed in the class, and then more than 2,400 genera. So this includes also the anamorphs and the theriomorphs, or the asexuals. These are counted separately. It's extremely diverse in terms of lifestyle. You have everything from the Antarctic to the tropics, from extremely tolerant to humans. There's basically no limiting factor in where you will find members of this class. So in 2009, we tried to map some of these in the paper of Schoch et al. In the Studies of Mycology. But as you can see, these lifestyles, although sometimes limited to specific lineages, they do occur across this whole class. And maybe some fun fact is also that some of the asexual forms also forms a synanamorph. So you have Ridderiella with its CBSEI synanamorph. So it's not always a single anamorph and a single telomorph or either one of the two. So something which you also encounter for some of the species in the class is a cryptic sex in apparently asexual species. So we have done a study on Cercospora where we could show that there's something going on in the genome, in the population, so it does have some sort of cryptic sex, although we never see the sexual form in nature or in culture. We came up with this bogustic hypothesis a couple of years ago, so this is a bit complicating for people that want to describe species, because most of the genera at some point were based on what host substrate it was found on, and that will then determine, oh, it's a new species or not. So what we found is that some of these things, they sort of hop onto a substrate and then they stay there, make a little bit of mycelium, a little bit of material to continue onto the next thing in search of its optimal substrate. So if you find it on this intermediate substrate, it might not be the true host. So we refer to this as the bogustic hypothesis. So some of these, I like to be in the company of others. Some of the other speakers also referred to this. We did some studies on niche sharing. So we looked at the single lesion and we saw how many isolates we can get out of there and how many different species. And it's actually quite diverse what you find in a single species. And especially if you have an herbarium specimen and you want to see your specific fungus and you have a sexual and an asexual form, you might make a wrong conclusion about which is which on such a shared niche. So we have some problems. We have what I would like to call the unsequenceables and unculturables. So we have Simonidotia, for example, that we had a postdoc from Germany some time ago with Simon, and he was able to get some LSU sequences out of this obligate biotroph, and he could show that it actually belongs to the Micus Aureliaceae. So even though it's not culturable, he could get some sequences out. In Fungal Planet, we described this Wensmania. It was from an apple tree in the Netherlands. And whatever we did with the fruiting bodies, we could not get any DNA or any sequence out. So even though it was fresh material, you sometimes have these things that just doesn't want to be sequenced for some odd reason. One of the problems is also to consolidate the nomenclature, and especially if you have a lot of synonymies. So you would think, okay, this should not be that difficult. For example, the type species of Uverbrownia is this Uverbrownia juvenis. So it's an asexual form. At some point it was synonymized, or it was linked to this Micus juvenis, which was then in the end called Micus nubilosa. And then a little bit later in a different publication, this was again placed into Teratosferia as a compnorph. So you would say, okay, if you want to go from the anamorph to the telomorph name, no problem. That would be the association. But then you need a third paper that says, oops, this proposed link between the sexual and asexual form was actually wrong. So then you cannot say that Uverbrownia juvenis is the same as Teratosferia nubilosa. So you need to navigate all of these different publications and synonymies and opinions to find some kind of consensus. I will just call this repository 1 and 2, because it doesn't matter from which one it comes. We have examples in both directions. So this species, Sporides majora, was described in 2010, so about 5 years ago. If you look in one, it only says it's Ascomycota. If you look in another one, it actually goes down into the Dithyramycetes, but not really accurately. You also have examples the other way around, that one will say more information than the other one. But if you actually go to the physical publication in which the species was described, then you will see it sits inside the Capnodiales and actually inside the Microstrelliaceae. So both repositories are actually wrong in where they place this specific species. So that's another confusing factor. I'm not a mycologist in the strict sense. I'm a trained molecular biologist, so I use a lot of GenBank, to the horror probably of most people in this room. But something that is also very confusing is that you sometimes have something, you have a species, it's described, it has isolate K3 in GenBank, and you have the GenBank number. And if it's a very new species, and Conrad was very efficient, you might call it the genus name SP, and then your initials with a date, and that's how it's then in the database. So now you go to the manuscript, you have this published species name, you have two culture collections, and then in the table it will say, well, culture collection 1 equals 2, with the GenBank number, with no reference to K3. And then even in another manuscript, you might have additional culture collection number, which is not linked to 1 or 2, but only to 1. And then you need to compile all of these to make sense of what data is actually out there for that specific species. So I actually like this quote from David Roy Smith, where he says, a good GenBank entry reflects good work, but a bad one breeds bad science. So we really need to be more consistent in how we do GenBank, how we update GenBank, and actually do update our entries in GenBank. So one of the biggest problems is scattered type information. So for this project, I wanted to find some more type information. And you have old literature, you have new literature, you have books. So some of these things are only published in the book and not in a journal. You saw this morning that some of them are online published, and then the difficulty of other languages. So some of them only available in the original Latin or the original German. And if you're lucky, you can actually read the font. Some of them are even in a font that it's almost impossible to read if you can follow the language. So what is the importance of knowing the types and the type species? It's sort of the core basis, because the type species determine what is the genus. So if you have a non-monophyletic genus, it will determine which clade gets the genus name. So it's extremely important to know where does my type species sit. So Septoria is one of those genera that was sort of a dumping ground for a lot of different species, and it was quite non-monophyletic. So a few years ago, one of our PhD students actually went in and he tried to freshly collect this thing. We tried all over Europe, we could not get it. I think we actually even offered a reward if somebody would collect it for us, and that also failed. So we got some herbarium specimens from many different years. And he got permission to actually try to isolate DNA from those. And he was successful. It's described in this paper at the top. So if you want to read up on his joyous efforts to get this done, it took him a couple of months to get this out. But he finally got a sequence out for Septoria cytici, and he could revise the whole concept of this genus. And now the genus radiated into many different Septoria-like genera, each with its own genus name. But that was only possible because we had the type species in our trees. So when I started, when we started with this idea of an overview of the Dithyramycetes, we already had the genera fungi database, which is about 2 years old or so. There was this review by Nalin just last year, revising the whole Dithyramycetes, the whole class, listing the names and suppression, etc. So a lot of has been done already on this class. So I was thinking, okay, what is left for me to do? Because there has been a lot of revision. Many people are quite actively working on the class, and especially on specific families or orders in this class. So I thought, okay, well, let's go back to basics, and we'll go find the type information of all type species. As I told you, these things are scattered, so it's very difficult to find them. And then try to assemble as much sequence information as possible for these type species, and even better if you can actually get from the X-type or type material sequence data from. And then to look at this list and see if it still makes sense. So the overall outcome that I would like to see for this project is some kind of Excel sheet with all of this updated information, this updated classification. And because this will be a community effort, you're all free to join in on this, to contribute. And this Excel sheet will also be freely available to whoever wants to use it in which way. So it will not be held by me as such, but it will be available for whoever wants to use this. I was talking to Joey and he was also saying, yeah, on the JGI website, they also have this sort of vague classification that might be better to be actualized, updated. So these kind of participants would actually benefit from such an update. So how to start with this? So a lot of manual checking of protologs, of published lists, and this is still ongoing. I thought, okay, well, it's about 2,500 genera. How long can it take? If you want to do it quite well, you maybe do 10 to 30 genera per day, and that's only the type species. I'm not talking about all of the species included in the genus. And then you have to try and search GenBank to find representative sequences for these genera, for these species. Luckily, Conrad and Barbara is quite good at harvesting the GenBank database, so they gave a lot of help. So for the purpose of this talk, I'm just looking at the assembled LSU sequences because it gives more or less an idea of the family, the genus, and the order level. Although there are some other data available, so you could, in the end, build some kind of combined tree consisting of multiple data sets. But for now, it was based on the LSU sequences. So this is a work in progress. So looking at only the LSU sequences, we have the orders. There are about 9 orders that are known from the type sequences, without the type, without any form of sequence of the type species. For 10 of them, we actually do have type sequences, or the type species from the type specimen. And then 7 of them are actually represented by a type species, but it's something else than X type or authentic type or whatever. So there's some kind of sequence data linked to the name, but it's not type material. For the families, we are actually not doing so well. We have 63 of these families for which we do not even have LSU sequences for the type species. So that's a little bit worrisome if you want to revise the overview taxonomy for the classification. For 31, we actually do have type species sequences from the type specimens, and that's actually not too bad, I think. But 42 of them, we have type species in there, but not from the type specimen. So in total in the data set, we have about 308 genera represented by LSU sequence for the type species with type specimens, and then another about 230 that do not have any types, or that are not from the type specimen itself. So before I go into the tree, I just want to explain the legend a little bit so that you can follow the trees. So if the name is in green or the block is in green, then it's a family or a gene, family or an order that is represented by the type species itself. If it's in red, it means that the type species is not included in the analysis. Okay? And then I told Constanza, I hope I will not be saying oops in my presentation. It seems to be a common word with this laser pointer. But we do have some oopses, and that's strings that are supposed to be in the deuteriomycetes seeds, but if you include it in the sequence data, it actually comes out in the wrong class. So if you have this combined list from Nyland's paper and the genera fungi, and you pop those genera into this phylogeny, it's not in the deuteriomycetes seeds. And the black ones, they are either not type species, type specimens, or they are listed as insatisidas. So the current classification as it was defined based on both genera fungi and Nyland is given at the back between these X's. So it's sort of a consensus classification, if you like. And I indicate the type site is where it, the type site is where it is known. So if you go down this tree, say LSU tree, you can see based on the large sampling that you would expect that you will hit the limitation of what is available in terms of resolution. So you do see these blue ones, these are the other orders. So they are popping up sort of all over this tree. So it gives you an indication of the limitation of LSU. But the sort of the terminal branches are actually quite consistent. So it's not that it's too much of an artifact. So I'll just briefly go down the tree to highlight some points. So this is basically Capnodialis, Dothodialis, and then Myrangialis. So actually, we have been playing a lot in our research group in the Capnodialis, especially Microcellular Teratosphaeria, the zirconia. And so as you can see that these are actually not too badly presented or represented. But we have this one here, which is was also always listed in the publications as all the inserted series, but it does have a family name. And what you can see from this data is it looks like it should belong in the Capnodialis. So it does give us, although we have a lot of data already from presentations, from publications for many of these groups, we can actually try to merge these unknowns into our phylogenies. So the next one I would point out is 2 minutes. Ah, that's going to be fun. It's the Pedraiaceae. It actually occurs in two places in the tree. So I was thinking we have a lot of Brazilians in the audience. So if this genus was, the type species was described from hair in Brazil. So if all of the Brazilians in the audience would leave us a hair sample when they go out at the back, then it would be nice if we can try to get this thing to sporulate on artificial medium. And then we can see which one of those two clades are the real Pedraia. So if you feel free to send me some samples as you go out. Okay, so these are three of these classes that I said, these things are supposed to be in the Dothoriomycetes, but they actually go in there. You would say, okay, maybe this is an artifact, but what is quite clear is that many of them are actually listed as inserted series. So these were the ones that were not really placed anyway. And many of them are actually represented by type strains. So this looks like it can actually be quite true. We have a paper going on Idrilla at the moment, which shows that it's actually supposed to be in the Zilla Realis. So I have some confidence in this anyway. We have some problem charts, this Strigolales, basically non-monophyletic at the moment, so that needs to be addressed. We have this order that was described last year without the type species in there, so that's also something to think about. Priesperalis has been quite well studied, but there are some few problems left. Lophiostomaceae, Leptospheraceae are a little bit non-monophyletic at the moment. But it can just be a classification issue. Kevin showed this morning how conserved some of these morphologies are. So it could be a classification issue. Once again, we have some things that are inserted series that probably warrants their own orders, own families. The Scriomyces is always a little bit basal, sort of next to Botrysphaeales. And then these always cluster together, this Cilidra bullarda, and it maybe warrants its own family and order. So some of the future plans, we need to continue updating this type database, add sequences, add more strains for these things that are not known from types to be certain that the ID is correct. Multi-gene trees where possible, add the non-LSU data to the LSU tree to see where does things, where are things supposed to go, double check the current classification, etc. And also throw out these things that are not the Dothoriomycetes sensu stricto. So some of the concluding remarks that I would like to make is we should be maybe more bold to epitypify, neotypify some of these species because they're really important for our phylogenies. We need to know where they go. For some of these genera, there will be there's a need for a correction of the current classification. Several of these unpublished or even published sequences need to be double-checked. What's a little bit worrisome to me is that there are quite a number of these type species that are not even known from the ITS sequence. So although they have the LSU or SSU sequence, there are no ITS sequences. And that's not so convenient if we have ITS as a standard barcode for fungi. Probably the biggest problem for us is lack of sequences, lack of culture, especially things that can be cultured that are not cultured or not in culture collections. And sort of adding onto the talk of Tom May this morning, there's really a need for a central place where you can find all of these information so that you can go and you can say, okay, I have this species, where are the types, where was it collected, are there any epitypes, where are the epitypes? Because this is takes a lot of time to try and gather all of this information. So I thank you all for listening. I invite you to collaborate, to contact me about this. And then although this quote is not was not in the context of Dothoriomycetes, but more on American political issues, I think it sort of summarizes where we are to some degree with the with the doves. So there are known knowns, and we have some things that are the known unknowns, and then also the unknown unknowns. And I think at that I will just leave the floor open for questions.